It's 7 o'clock. All right. Welcome, everyone. One of the things I really miss about doing in-person events is that opportunity to walk around the room and say hi to people and connect with everyone. You know, when we sign into the Zoom, we're all gathering here. And so I did suggest that over in the chat, if you'd like to say hi, if you're joining us from somewhere other than Topeka, I'd be interested to see some of that. If you want to drop a note in the chat to say hello. And also, if you have a book recommendation for something you've read and loved lately, aside from The Lost Apothecary, feel free to drop a recommendation into the chat to share with our community of readers, and I will put those together into a list to share out after the event as well. And we may still have a few people popping in, but most of our registrants are now in here, so we're going to get started on time, so we have plenty of time for our Q&A with Sarah and Andrew. So with that, just want to jump right in. Welcome to tonight's event hosted by your Topeka and Shawnee County Public Library. We are so excited to welcome Sarah Penner, the author of The Lost Apothecary. And I would also like to welcome Andrew Howard, if you'd give us a wave, Andrew, who is one of the co-owners of our local indie bookstore, Roundtable Bookstore in Noto. If you didn't know that we had a great indie bookstore, or you haven't had a chance to check them out yet, I highly encourage you to get in there. It's a beautiful store, and Andrew is great at helping you find a wonderful book for yourself or for a gift. So definitely go check them out. Couple of quick library things before we get started. Wanted to first give thanks to Tim and the Kansas Book Festival, who helped us connect with Sarah for tonight. Check them out on Facebook, and I will send out some links after this event as well. The event is back this year after a hiatus last year due to COVID, like many things, and they are bringing it back better and stronger than ever on the Washburn campus, and it's going to be a really cool event with lots of stellar authors, lots of opportunities to find books and connect with other readers. So check that out. And then quick library plug, we'd love for you to join us for summer reading on our Top City Reads Together Facebook group online. So we will be reading a book together in June. We'll read State of Wonder by Ann Patchett and have a book discussion on that. In July, we'll focus on graphic novels and exploring the many different options out there. And in August, we'll read Candace Millard's River of Doubt. We're theming around rainforest to go along with our library's gallery exhibit. So we are going to have a lot of fun reading and discussing together. There are links in the chat for you to check out The Lost Apothecary from the library if you haven't had a chance to read yet, or to visit the Roundtable Bookstore's website so that you can buy your own copy. We will have signed book plates. I apologize for the delay on that myself, but those will be at the bookstore that you can go in to visit and pick up after the fact. So if you've bought a copy already, or you buy one after, or if you are the lucky person who wins this copy that I'm going to give away at the end of the event, you'll be able to get a signed book plate to personalize that for you. So with that, I would like to introduce our star of the evening and our interviewer of the evening. So first up, Andrew Howard is one of the owners of Roundtable Bookstore. His favorite genre is fantasy, but he enjoys reading all kinds of different books. At the bookstore, which started in 2019, so yes, just a year before COVID, and they're surviving and thriving. They host D&D nights, open mic nights. They had been looking at getting involved with our story slams in Topeka. They host a book club there in the store. They offer baked goods from Baking Traditions. It's just fabulous. So make sure you get over there to visit. And we're so excited to have Andrew here to interview Sarah tonight. And of course, our star of the evening, Sarah Penner, is a debut novelist and works in finance. So very different day job from the creative and research-oriented work that we see here. And she lives in Florida with her family and with her dog. Is it Zoe?
Yes, Zoe. She's a miniature dachshund. Yep.
How cute. So please join me in giving them a very warm welcome. And Andrew, take it away.
Hey, thank you. That was like great. You could be doing this. Sarah, same thing. Thank you so much. I was so excited. I had already read your book and been telling people about it. And Miranda sent me a message and said, hey, would you want to join us in doing this author interview. And I was like, yes, this would be fantastic. So yeah, so thank you for the book and for agreeing to do this.
Of course. Thank you for having me.
Yeah. So the big question that I think especially people in this chat want to know about is you actually grew up in Kansas, correct?
Yes. Yes. So a few things before we dive in. I appreciate that you both have thanked me, but I have to thank both you and Miranda for the opportunity to be chatting with your readers tonight. And as Miranda said a few minutes ago, I would love to do book plates for anyone who has purchased or plans to purchase the book through you to support our local indie bookstores, which is so important now more than ever. The book plates that I do, they're hand stamped with a little apothecary vial. And then of course I would sign it and put your name on there if you'd like. So just something to keep in mind. But I think that over the last year, it's been really amazing to see indie bookstores kind of rise to the challenge and find creative ways to keep their shops running. And so just huge kudos to you, Andrew, for everything that I'm sure you're doing on your side as well. So to answer your question, I am from Kansas. I was born and raised, and that's why tonight's event is actually very special to me, and I accepted it without even thinking another moment on it. I get a lot of event requests, and just for my own peace of mind and sanity, I've been unfortunately having to decline a lot, but this one I was like, yes, like Kansas people, I'm in. So I grew up in the town is called Hillsdale. It's about 20 minutes south of Overland Park. I went to school in Overland Park, truly from birth through age 18. I lived in the same house in the country in Hillsdale, Kansas. And then I went to the University of Kansas in Lawrence. So I studied finance, as Miranda said, and I worked in finance in Wichita for about a decade. I worked at Koch Industries, which I'm sure many of you have heard of. And then my husband and I just decided he was born and raised in Garden City area, like Western Kansas. And so we just decided, like, if we don't get out and see something else, like, we're never going to. So about 4.5 years ago, we sold our beautiful house in Wichita. We quit 2 amazing jobs, and we packed up a U-Haul with our dog, and we drove 2 days down here to Florida, and best decision we've ever made. We absolutely love it here. I'm proud now to consider myself a resident of the Sunshine State, but of course always have and will keep those roots in Kansas where I'm from. So I think that people who are born or raised or live in the Midwest, it's just a special breed of people. And there's like a level of humility and kindness and gratitude that you just don't find other parts of the world. And so I'm glad to take that with me no matter where I go.
Yeah, for sure. And I think that comes through in a lot of like your social media and things that you do, you know, thanking other authors and promoting mm-hmm. other people, the story of you going and presenting to your goddaughter's class and mm-hmm. I mean, all that was just, it was fantastic. So I think that's one reason, one of the many reasons that you're a great author, is you do carry that Midwest kindness through into what you're doing. So thank you for that also. And that's enough thank yous all around. So Miranda hinted at it a little. I think if anyone hasn't read the book, first of all, read the book. But second of all, the amount of research you did in this really comes through. It's not something that you just slapped together, not that any author does that. But do you want to talk a little bit about the research that went into this and kind of how you got onto it?
Yes. Yeah. So you're exactly right that the research was an enormous component of not only originating the story idea, but actually executing it as well. So I have with me a couple of the resources that I utilized. And if anyone's interested in a more extensive list, my website, sarahpenner.com, there's a resources tab there that has all different books. So on the poisoning side of things, because I mean, obviously the apothecary is a poisoner. I think we've established that by now. That's not a spoiler. It's on the back cover. So a couple of nonfiction resources for anyone who's interested in learning more about real life poisoning cases in the UK in the 19th and 20th centuries. This first one is called Poisoned Lives, and it's by Catherine Watson. This is a great, lots of case studies about different victims, how the culprits in those cases were found and charged. And then this one is The Secret Poisoner by Linda Stratman. And this is more data-based and has more information on the actual toxins themselves and sort of how they impact the body and how they can also be picked up like in autopsies. So that's a really interesting one. And then this third one that is a more kind of whimsical contemporary title is Wicked Plants. And this is by Amy Stewart. And for if we have any gardeners or anyone who likes flowers, this would make like a great Mother's Day gift, actually, with maybe like a cool, like a set of like little cute succulents or something like that. But this is all different poisonous plants and toxic plants, and kind of dives into like their history, when and where they were discovered, what the actual chemical toxin is inside of the plant. So this made for really interesting reading as well. All of that said, you have to remember that The Lost Apothecary took place before we had forensic toxicology. I say that in my author's note at the end. The ability to detect poison during an autopsy really did not exist until 1850, 1860. My book is set in 1791. So that's part of why Nella the apothecary could get away with her sinister work. And you have to also remember that a lot of the things that we may know about today, like certain plants that are poisonous, they had not yet been discovered in 1791. So I had to utilize a number of historical resources, like digitized manuscripts or pharmacopoeias, which that word is mentioned in The Lost Apothecary, and it's essentially an encyclopedia of drugs. Or medicines. So I looked at old, like from 1500s, 1600s, 1700s, these old, almost impossible to read pharmacopoeias that are digitized online to make sure that whatever was in Nella's shop really would have been in the shop in 1791. And I wanted to just keep it as authentic as I could in that way. And where I took some creative liberties, I was just talking to someone about this today, was how these poisons were hidden and dispensed in various food and wine. I really didn't research that. I had a lot of fun making that stuff up in a way that seemed logical to me. So for instance, wolf's bane is a root, and people say that it's very bitter. Of course, it's also very toxic, so I wasn't going to go try it myself. But I've heard that it's very bitter. And so when I was thinking like, okay, what would I do with something really fibrous that's a root and it's bitter? Horseradish. So that's why Nella says in her story, or in her advice, to put it in a bitter horseradish sauce. So that's where I took some creative liberties and just had a lot of fun with the fictional part of the story. But all of the actual poisons and what they do to the human body, and the kind of encyclopedia at the back of the book that has a list of poisons, that is all fairly accurate and the result of my research.
Yeah, that's one of the things that I really enjoy and why I recommend this to anyone who has any interest in it whatsoever, even if they don't have an interest, is you do really well mesh different things. So a lot of times, you know, historical fiction can be kind of a little dry at times, you know, too research heavy, but the things that you took creative liberties on, I really enjoyed. It really made it feel not like a data book. You know, it was something, it was a story that we were along for the ride with, and you had the mystery part and everything else. So,
yeah, I think you make a good point there, because I would, if someone told me I want to learn about 18th century London, and that's their primary goal, I would not give them my book to read. Like, you're not going to learn that much. I don't even say who's sitting on the throne. I purposely like steered clear of any of that. You're going to get maybe a brief sense of like the kind of things people ate, but like, I didn't dive into how they're getting around town, what their gowns look like. Like, I kind of gloss over, all of that. And I really just delve into the poison shop. And so, if, you know, I think it's an interesting way to look at how authors have different styles. Like, if anyone here is a fan of Ken Follett, I absolutely love Ken Follett. Who doesn't love, but his books are like very thick, very dense. And if you want to know about these little towns in medieval, whatever year it was that his, like the Pillars of the Earth, like that's what I would tell someone who wants that really dense, sort of purist historical fiction. So it's just different styles. And I like to think actually The Lost Apothecary more so is like a thriller that parts of it are set 200 years ago. Now, of course, when a publisher produces a book and it's got to go on a bookshelf, we need a genre, we need a shelf to stick it on. So they went with historical fiction. But even Book of the Month, you know, it was a Book of the Month main pick, which is a huge win. And the day that they released it, they had it listed as fantasy. And then 72 hours later, they had changed it to historical fantasy. So even Book of the Month, which has been around for 100 years and has a million subscribers, they didn't even know what genre to slot the book into, which is kind of fun to think, like, you know, it doesn't really have a place, and that's okay. So it makes it unique and fresh.
Yeah, I will tell you, it has moved 3 different times in our shop. Because when we first got it, like one of the wonderful things is covers nowadays are mm-hmm. so beautiful. And so you look at the cover and you're like, man, all that vibrant color and things, like that's probably a fantasy book. So before we had read it, that's where we put it. Well, then we read it and we were like, nope, not fantasy. And so mm-hmm. then we put it in mystery and thriller, but we've got mm-hmm. it in our window and we've got it above our regular fiction, and we have it in our book club is doing it this month. So we have it everywhere. But yeah, that's one of the things that I think modern fiction is doing a really good job of, is kind of blending those genres where it's not, yes. I'm reading only historical fiction or I'm reading only fantasy. It's a little bit of everything. And I think that's another thing you blend really well in your book.
Yeah. Yeah. Thank you. It's interesting to hear from a bookseller's perspective that you also have kind of struggled with where to put it. I think enough people have heard of it now that they're probably walking into bookstores and saying, like, do you have this title? But it'll be interesting, you know, years down the road when the buzz has died down, to see where bookstores end up placing it. And I would guess it's probably going to go in historical fiction, but who knows, it may be all over the place.
Yeah, exactly. So the next big thing that jumped out at me, because I knew nothing about this until I read your book, and then it was that whole psychological theory of, I heard about it everywhere once I read your book, mm-hmm. but mudlarking. Yes. I did not know mudlarking was a thing. And actually, we've got a customer on the chat right now who I had a huge discussion with about mudlarking in London. So give us a little bit of background on why you wanted to pull mudlarking into this, besides the fact that it takes place in London.
Yes. So for anyone who's not read the book, who doesn't know what mudlarking is and why we're talking about it. Mudlarking means basically scrounging around along a body of water. And in this instance, we're talking about the River Thames in central London. And you're looking amongst the mud and the rocks for interesting or older historical artifacts. And mudlarking not only as a way for people to make money, because people used to sell what they found, but as a pastime, it's been around for hundreds of years. So like in the Victorian era, children would go down to the river and sell the things that they found in order to help provide money for the family. So, but it's kind of had a resurgence in recent years as a hobby. And so about 5 years ago for Christmas, I got this book called London in Fragments by Ted Sandling. And he has all of these beautiful pictures of what he has found in the river. And one of the things is this apothecary jar, which he dates mid 17th century. And I remember seeing this and thinking, like, what if this had half of a number or half of a name or just a partial clue? And I found that and I started digging and realized that I stumbled on this unsolved murder mystery from hundreds of years ago. And therein is exactly Caroline's journey. That's the start of what happens, except she finds a vial, not a fragment of a jar. But I think part of why that idea was so compelling for me as an entry into her path and her exploration is because in historical fiction, especially dual timeline, where we have a present day character who's solving a mystery, a lot of times that character will end up in like grandma's attic or a library, somewhere where there's like a journal that just kind of has a really nicely placed clue that kicks off the story. And there's nothing wrong with that. I've read many books with beginnings like that, that are excellent books, but I knew that I wanted Caroline to start this sleuthing in a more fresh and original way that had not been done before. And I also had gotten this book and I was intrigued by the idea of finding things in the river. And so that it was just like a perfect confluence. And that was from day one, I knew that was how I was going to start Caroline's start of the story. And then I did go mudlarking. So people always want to know, like, have you gone mudlarking? I did go in July of 2019. And so at that point, the book was pretty well written, but I was working on revisions with my agent. She and I had not sold the book yet to Park Row Books. So I always show like a few of the things that I found. You have to have a permit. So if anyone, once lockdowns are done, if anyone wants to go mudlarking, you have to get a permit. They do have plain clothed police officers who will ask to see it. And it's a steep fine if you don't have your permit. And you also need to watch very closely the tide tables to make sure that you go out when the tide is not rising, because if you get caught without nearby steps, you can be in truly a life-threatening situation. I didn't know this, but the River Thames, the tide rises 24 feet twice a day. So, I mean, you do not want to be stuck in that river when the tide comes in 24 feet. Like, that's very dangerous. So all kinds of pottery, lots of blues. Blue dye was kind of what they used most often. From a historical perspective, lots of clay pipes. So anyone who's read the book will remember when Bachelor Alf says that he finds a lot of these, because these really were just like cigarettes. You would just put the tobacco in the barrel and then smoke it once. And when you were done, you would throw it in the river. And so we find all these fragments, and like, this is definitely at least 200 years old. So how cool is that to just think, like, even just now, I'm like, who held this? Like, it was probably a man. But like, what was his life like? Was he married? Did he have kids? Like, it's just a connection that you can't really get that through any other way. Yeah. And then really this bag is just full of pottery. I mean, I could show you like 100 pieces just like this. So very fun. If you want to see some of the other things that I found that I could not bring home, like there's a few animal bones, you can, I'm easy to find on Instagram, and people are welcome to go to the very bottom of my, like my first few photos that I put up, and there's a picture of everything I found. So mudlarking is awesome. Total fun. And so many people have learned about it from this book. And that's really cool for me to see that people are like, oh my gosh, I'm planning to go mudlarking next year. So it's been fun.
Yeah. And there, I think someone put a comment in the chat. There's like YouTube videos of these people who, like, that's what they do, is they go mudlarking, and they have, since your book has been published, those viewerships have exploded.
Yeah.
Which I think is great. And yep. Which another thing I appreciate about this book is, for me, one of the things that makes a book great and something that will stand the test of time, which I think The Lost Apothecary will, is that it makes you want to learn about other things. It makes you want to read mm-hmm. other books. And this absolutely, like, immediately I was like, okay, I got to find out about mudlarking. I got to learn more about apothecaries. I got, you know, just like the books yep. you showed us. And so I appreciated that. And that's one thing I think that kind of we in the United States don't get to experience, is like, you could pull up pieces of Roman pottery. You could, I mean, there's no telling, like, those things you're holding in your hand that are 200 years old, those don't exist here, you know?
Yeah. Yeah. And you're right. People find Roman coins every day. So there are a few really well-known mudlarkers on Instagram. If you just type in mudlark, like, you'll start finding the accounts. And I'm so envious when I stumble across the things that they find, because I didn't find anything like that. Part of it is because I'm not experienced at it. I mean, they kind of know the spots, and their eyes are so attuned to like changes or breaks in pattern, which I mentioned that as well in the story. And it just takes practice like anything else. But I mean, to anyone who's like, no way, do they really find Roman stuff? Like, no, they do like daily. It's phenomenal what you can find.
So I know you have been to London, obviously, because you've gone mudlarking, and you have talked about wanting to go back. Had you been before you wrote the book?
Yes, many times. So we mentioned earlier that I worked in finance, and I'm not sure if Miranda realized this, but just last month I resigned after 13 years working in corporate America. So I'm now writing full time, which is so exciting. Thank you. Yeah, it's a huge achievement and the dream of so many people. And I'm thrilled to have the opportunity to do that. So one of the really wonderful serendipitous things about my day job was they had an office in London and they sent me over pretty regularly. And so I would have nights and weekends to kind of just do whatever I wanted. So I've seen like most of London many times. And I love it. I feel like I must have lived there in a past life or something. Like I'm just very comfortable. I'm very intrigued by the city. And would like to someday move out that way. My husband and I have talked about that. Unfortunately, the UK is not the best place for American expats. There's just a lot of red tape. And then also it's extraordinarily expensive. So it may be just a travel destination. But you know, even the next project I'm working on, I can't get out of London. Like I just love it that much. So it's set in London also, a different era, a little bit later, but I love the city. So I am always pulling up these old maps and looking at them. And it's just very intriguing for me.
Yeah, that's awesome. And I hate when people try and pressure authors to say like, when's your next book? You know, I'm still waiting on the next Game of Thrones book. So, I try not to do that, but I'm super excited to hear that you're already working on something else. But
yeah,
that's another thing that I think you pulled together really well in this book is there are so many different things that come into it. You have the library, you have the mudlarking, you have the cool maps that are almost visceral in the way you describe mm-hmm. them. You can feel the maps like on your fingers and how they would look and smell and everything. And it's fantastic. And I think it comes through that you have been to London multiple mm-hmm. times and that you love it because it's not like, oh yeah, somewhere north of the Thames is this place. You know, it's like, she left, she turned left, she turned right, you know, all these great things. So,
yeah. Well, thank you. I'm glad that comes through. Yeah, you're right. I do a lot of directional instruction, which probably isn't necessary, but when you're exactly right. When an author likes something, you're going to be able to tell because you're going to see where they're spending their energy. And so it makes as a reader, an interesting exercise to pull open a book. And you can just tell, I can just tell as an author, like where that author had to revise a passage, where they had to put a pretty little bow on a problem, where, you know, where their real interests lie outside of writing. Like it's fun to look for clues like that.
Yeah, for sure. So this is one of those questions that I'm always intrigued to hear mm-hmm. about from authors. Obviously not everyone is as fortuitous as you to get a debut book that is just off the charts successful and mega popular, which you deserve it. I'm not saying you don't deserve it. You deserve it. But how many books had you written before this one really got picked up and took off?
So it's very common for authors to write a manuscript or two that just kind of is a flop before you have your debut. And that's very much what happened for me as well. So for anyone who's not aware, an author does not sell a book directly to a publisher. You go through an agent, and getting the agent, a reputable agent, is, in my opinion, arguably the most difficult part of the process. If you have a good agent, and you have a decent story premise, they're probably at some point going to be able to sell your book. But getting the agent, that gatekeeper, is so challenging. And so with my first manuscript, I was rejected by more than 130 agents. So like just the word no over and over. Yeah, your eyes are wide. Imagine how I felt, like all of those emails. And my poor husband, like, you know, he wanted good things for me so badly, but he's also the person that I would go to when I got these rejections, and just his shoulders would sink every time. So it was a character building, I guess you could say. But anyways, I took some feedback that I had gotten from people, and when I started writing The Lost Apothecary, and one of those pieces of feedback was that I wanted to give my characters more agency and really make them the heroes of their own story. And my first manuscript that never got agented, and of course, therefore never published, that it was more so the plot was a lot of things happening to the characters, and they were responding to the things happening instead of being more proactive and making the plot happen with their own decisions. So The Lost Apothecary, I mean, you open the book with a woman who's making poison to kill a man. So if that's not agency, I don't know what is. And sure enough, like that did the trick. So I queried 12 agents and got 5 offers of representation with The Lost Apothecary. So completely different story than my first book. And people always ask, like, would you try again to get that first manuscript published? And the answer is like a vehement no. I have so many other better ideas. I've learned a lot more about how to structure and write a good story, I hope. So I'm not interested in revisiting that manuscript. It just kind of sits on my Google Drive, and I don't really have any reason to revisit it.
Yeah, that's, so this is terrible, but I was hoping your story was going to be something like that, because I think a lot of times people don't realize what authors go through to get books published. You know, it's not, hey, here's this book, and all of a sudden I've sold 100,000 copies. And so the idea of getting rejected 130 times, like my brain can't even comprehend that.
Yeah. And I will say also there is, the rejection and the hurdles don't even stop after you have sold your first book. So for instance, I wrote a whole nother book last year during COVID, and it didn't get a whole lot of traction. It got a little bit of traction, but not the traction I wanted to see for my sophomore book. And so that is why I'm now working on something new that has already, with the right people, it has gotten a lot of traction. And so it's not like it just suddenly gets easier. Like you've figured out the key to unlock this door to success. And even like Kate Quinn, very well-known historical fiction author, she said something on Twitter the other day, like she has like so many manuscripts that she keeps benching. Like she just, they don't hit the mark for whatever reason. And she's written a ton. And so, it's doesn't really speak to your skill or your talent. A lot of times it's just timing and what the industry is looking for.
Yeah. And Kate Quinn is very good. She's also, in a good spot right now because World War II fiction is like bonkers. So, yeah, she's in a good spot.
Yeah. World War II fiction is it. I feel like that's 5 or 6 years now that we're just seeing like so many titles every month come out. And that I will say, I rarely say I'll never do something. That era doesn't really, I find it very difficult to even read about. And there's no way, like I will never write a book. Not because it's not an important era to write about, but I just can't go there for some reason.
Yeah, no, I agree. And that's another thing that I appreciated about your book was that it's not, you know, late 1700s, there were obviously other things really important to Americans happening. And so we don't really think about what was happening in the UK during that time. And so I that's one of the things I appreciated was that you did choose this kind of time period. Next question, and I apologize because probably not a lot of you thought this way, but I had always kind of, apothecaries to me were always like men. So one of the things that I appreciated in this book was that Nella was obviously a female and was making it her mission to help other females who in this time period had nothing really that they could do about anything. Mm-hmm. So was that, like, did you go into it knowing that this was going to be female centric, or did that kind of evolve? How did that come about?
No, I knew from before I wrote the first word that it would be a story centered on women. And it's interesting that you say that in your mind, apothecaries have always kind of, you've envisioned them as men, because I'm actually the opposite. Even before I started writing this story, I thought of an apothecary more as like a healer, maybe someone who uses the gifts of the earth. And so that naturally kind of feels more feminine towards, you know, feminine to me. But I think that, you know, in terms of actual historical accuracy, you're correct. Like most apothecaries or druggists or kind of the predecessors of what we know as modern day pharmacists were men. And they were ranked right up there with physicians and surgeons, during the era. So you're right. But I never questioned that the story would be about three women. And I knew the apothecary was going to be a woman who sought to help others. And it was just a shop for women. And that was a principle that I really had to take a lot of time to think through, like, why is her shop just for women? Why does she hold that principle so close and fight for that so strongly? And I think one of my favorite parts of the book is where she says that it's because she wants a safe place for women who don't want to be kind of inspected by these male doctors. And I think we see that, like, even in today, I mean, a lot of women prefer and feel more comfortable with female physicians. And so there's so many things when writing historical fiction, like interesting ways to compare and contrast today versus then. And there's little things just like that. But then there's bigger things just about betrayal and trust and how that never changes. And so it's always an interesting exercise in the what's changed and the what hasn't.
Yeah. And so I've been reading some of the comments as they pop up, and what you said about kind of the healer and the using what the earth gives and stuff. And that, I'm so glad you said that, because that absolutely changed my understanding of it right then, because I do, mm-hmm. to me, that is more of a female persona, but I had always thought of more the pharmacist type thing when I thought about apothecaries.
Yeah.
So that's interesting. I like that. I appreciate that. Thank you. So last thing, because I have to, maybe not last thing, we'll see how long Miranda gives me. I read somewhere that one of your big author influences is Aaron Morgenstern, which I love Aaron Morgenstern. The Night Circus and Starless Sea were both way up in my list. So tell us a little bit, like, how did you discover Aaron? What about their writing kind of speaks to you?
Yeah. So there's a couple of things. I mean, in terms of, if we use the Night Circus, for instance, which if anyone has not read the Night Circus, highly recommend it. It's one of the more creative, I guess we could, you know, we were talking earlier about genre bending stories. I think of it as fairly genre bending in that it's mostly fantasy. I mean, the whole thing is kind of about this magical circus. But it also, you can tell just through what the people are wearing, it's taking place like in the Victorian-ish era. And so there are some historical, you know, light historical elements there. And then there's also romance. And so it's it definitely is cross-genre. So I like that. That's kind of the first thing that I'm like, okay, if other big successful authors are doing this, like, why can't anyone? But what I really like about the Night Circus, and I noticed it immediately because when I read, I can't help but analyze and sort of inspect the way an author puts words together. So we're taught, and when I say we, I mean like as students in school and even as authors, we're taught to write in the active voice. So like Sarah pet the dog. then the flip of that is the passive voice, where the subject is sort of at the start of the sentence. So the dog was pet by Sarah. We're taught to avoid that passive voice. But the night circus is full of passive language. And I remember reading that thinking, like, how the hell did her editor let her do this? Like, we are allowed to break rules. I didn't realize we could break rules like this. And so I finished, like, I closed that book and I thought, I'm going to start putting passive sentences in my book, because I think they're poetic, and there's a time and a place where the passive voice actually sounds really lovely and atmospheric and can be right for the story. And so I think that just the rule breaking that she's done was inspirational for me. And that those are kind of the two main takeaways and why I really like The Night Circus.
Yeah, for sure. That's her writing. Even if you're not a fantasy person, just the way that she writes and kind mm-hmm. of what you said, the rule breaking and stuff is phenomenal. So yeah, that's very high up on mine. So I know that, you know, books kind of take on a life of their own sometimes as you start to write them and you don't know where they're going to go and things. I don't want to have you spoil anything, but what was kind of the biggest surprise or twist for you as you were going through and writing the book?
Yes. So, at the very end of the story, Nella's final chapter, and I don't really want to say what happens. And so I'm going to kind of speak in vague terms in case anyone hasn't read it, but that final chapter belonging to Nella, where she's walking to someone's house to deliver some news, and she's in very, very ill health. That was the last paragraph or the last chapter, I'm sorry, that I wrote in the whole book. And it was very late in the process. And what I meant to accomplish with that chapter that I couldn't really see until the very end, and so it was a bit of a twist and a surprise for me, was that I needed to give Nella some sort of hope. Like, her story had originally closed out in a very sad way, kind of just with like a period at the end of the sentence, and like the reader pretty much thinks that was it for her. And my goal in that last chapter was to say, maybe it's up to the reader to interpret it, but maybe that wasn't the end for Nella. Like, maybe her story could continue. So that was a surprise for me when I wrote it, but a hopeful, like, enlightening surprise that left me feeling really good. And like, that was the right ending to her story.
Yeah, for sure. I think there were a lot of ways that this could have just stopped at a very dark place. And so not that all books have to end on hopeful note, but I think this did achieve that. And I think it added to the book a lot. So do I have time for one more, Miranda? Okay. So your favorite heroine in the book?
My favorite character has always been Eliza. And I think it's because she's so youthful, inquisitive, stubborn, and smart. And I think that she balances a lot of the darkness and the pain that we see in Nella. Even at the beginning of the story, she runs her finger down this soot-stained stone wall and reveals the unblemished stone beneath it. And that is what she does to Nella's heart over the course of the story as well. She kind of reveals this goodness that still exists, even though Nella is painted as a very vengeful, hurting woman. So Eliza has always been my favorite. And people always ask, is there going to be a sequel someday? And while nothing is in the works right now, I've always said that I feel like Eliza's story, I left enough open doors at the end for her. And I did that strategically, that I would love to someday, like, start with basically the day after. I don't want to give away any spoilers, so I'm going to actually not say what I was going to say, but there's a lot of open doors that, that I could run with Eliza.
Yeah. My questions, I'm like, I want to ask this, but I don't want to, want to spoil things. Also, if you were ever to open a bookstore, Blackfriars Shop of Magic Baubles and Books, wonderful. If I didn't already have a name for our bookstore, that would be it. Like, perfect.
Yep.
So last kind of thing, I know authors are kind of represented in all of their characters, right? There's a little mm-hmm. bit of you in everything, but I know, good, glad I'm, Dawn, I'm glad we aren't spoiling it for you. But Gaynor, the woman archivist librarian, yeah. is that kind of, is there a lot of you in her?
There is what I wish that I could be in her. I've always said, every so often, like on social media, people will say, what's your dream job? And my dream job, short of being an author, because then you get to write about whatever you want to write about, it would be an archivist in the rare books room of the British Library in London, because literally what they get to do all day is they get to request these cool old manuscripts and books that are hundreds of years old, and they get to like deliver them to the researcher or the student, and just like all day long they get to do these filing and this recording and digitizing of these amazing documents. And so basically what Gaynor does for a living is what I would love to do in a different life.
I wondered if that was a connection for you.
Yeah.
So. I've asked one more than I told Miranda I would ask. So thank you, Sarah. That I'm so excited for your next book. This book was wonderful. And thank you for doing this event.
Oh, thank you for these wonderful questions.
Yeah, this is great. I have so enjoyed listening and learning from you, Sarah. I want to open it up to you readers. If you have a question, you can drop that in the chat, or if you feel like unmuting and asking your question that way, I think we can get in several here, and then we'll do a drawing for a copy of the book before we have to say goodnight. Who has a question for Sarah? One? I bet that Andrew has some more, if not. Sarah, I wonder if you could tell us a little bit about that cover. I have heard that you,
yes, you
had a little bit of a surprise when you saw this.
Yeah, so everyone I think has seen this beautiful cover. And I'll kind of give you some insight into how we got to this beautiful final product. And if anybody wants also to hear from the actual art director who pulled this together, there's about a 5-minute video on YouTube. If you just Google cover design, The Lost Apothecary, she walks through some of the original cover concepts that that HarperCollins like nixed. And that video that's out there, like they had to have their legal team review it and everything to make sure that they could show that artwork, but it's all good. So if anyone's interested in knowing more. So this is where we landed in the first iteration that I got in my inbox. This was many months ago. There was a dragonfly up here in the blank space. And I told them, get rid of the dragonfly because there is no dragonfly in the story. So we don't need one on the cover. The butterfly here was orange, kind of resembling a monarch. And I asked them to make it blue because that has more of the magical realism sense in it. And they made it so outrageously bright blue that I went into Microsoft Paint on my computer and I darkened it. And I showed them like, this is the blue that I wanted. And that's almost exactly what we got. This green beetle has remained the same. Anyone who's read the book knows why there's a green beetle, arguably the most important part of the book. And then they built out, like, this is, you can't tell on the screen, but this is embossed gold foil. So it of course catches the light, but it also has a little bit of texture as well. And I think that that's about it. I mean, overall, like this is very much the initial cover concept that landed in my email. And I was fortunate enough because we were in a pretty competitive situation when we first sold the book. So we were able to negotiate the contract in a pretty competitive way. And so my agent was able to secure final cover approval from the author, which is actually unusual from what I've heard. Like typically the publisher, they can kind of do their stamp of approval and move on, but they actually had to get my approval before we proceeded. And that I so was glad for that because there were a lot of refinements that, like I just discussed, that were important to me to have. So overall, it was a great process. And so many people have said they picked the book up just because of its cover, which means the art team did their job fabulously.
Yes. And what a fabulous agent you have. Mm. But yes. Somebody mentioned early on in this chat thread that pretty much everybody they've talked to about this book has mentioned the gorgeous cover. So yes, they did very good work there. I see that Diane has her hand raised. Diane, have a question for Sarah.
Hi, Sarah. I've been dying to ask you and excuse me, about the current character's final action in the book and really take you to task on that. But one of your comments, yeah, I've been waiting for her. But one of your comments earlier kind of leaves that open to telling
I know what you're talking about, who she is. Yeah, I know what you're referring to, Diane, and I don't think it's a spoiler. It's not actually a spoiler that because we know Caroline finds a vial at the very beginning of the story. And it's not a spoiler to reveal that at the end of the story, she throws it back into the water. And that has angered some readers. But there is, in my mind, such an obvious reason for that. And that is that this vial has now changed like multiple women's lives. And so it's Caroline's way of kind of giving it back to the river because you never know who's going to find it next and what journey it may set that individual on in a path of redemption and self-independence and self-reliance. So it's either that or she just takes it home and it sits on her dresser for the rest of her life, which in my opinion is so unsatisfying and even selfish. So to throw it back to the river and kind of give it back to the universe in the hopes that maybe it helps someone else someday was very logical for me.
Okay.
So I will say I have terrible handwriting. My number one question, why did she throw the bottle back? Because everything I read and everyone who has ever asked me, that is their number one question, is why throw the bottle back? And that's what I got out of it too, Sarah. So I'm so glad that I wasn't leading people astray.
Yeah, I mean, truly, like what else would she do with it? It would sit on a nightstand for her life. Like, it just seems like, you know, we know that this vial can do more than that for the world and for people. And so like, why not give it back to the river? That was my thought.
Absolutely. I thought it was very well done, but that is the number one question I get.
I think that was a great answer. I see that Jamie has her hand up with a question. Hi, Jamie. We've appreciated your contributions to the chat tonight as well.
I'm very chatty. This is where I get all my my social time is via Zoom, and then I'm quiet for the rest of the night. Hi, Sarah. Hi,
Jamie. Hi.
Are you sick of seeing me yet?
No, so everyone on the call knows Jamie has been one of the most wonderful supporters of The Lost Apothecary from very early on. And so no, Jamie, I'm never will get sick of you.
I tell you that the cat was just yowling 5 seconds ago and I was like, shh, we're going to go talk to Sarah. There's a question I had. I actually asked this in an chat ages ago, I feel, but it's such a cool question. And something Kendra said in the chat reminded me of it. If you had an apothecary, what symbol would you put on your rock?
Oh, yes. Okay. So I think what I would do is maybe one of two things, if I can give two answers. One of my favorite emojis on when I'm texting or social media or whatever is the little seedling. It's just a tiny little seedling with two little baby leaves. And I love that because A, I love being outside, but B, I love this concept of like constant growth in our lives. And what does a seedling have to do but just grow and go places? And I think that that's all of us every day in our lives. Like we grow on micro levels, like maybe this week, I'm going to try and have a tough conversation with a friend. And then we grow on macro levels. Like I'm going to make a career change or do something like move across the country. So the seedling, I think, represents that growth. So that would be my first thing. But my other idea would be, so my astrology symbol, I'm a Leo. And so whatever astrology symbol that is, I feel like I am a Leo through and through, like, just the lion hearted, like brave, kind of rebellious. But you know, on the flip side can also be, kind of selfish sometimes. Like, I just feel like I am a classic Leo. So that would be my other symbol that I might put on a vial.
I love that. Okay. As we're wrapping up here with 5 minutes remaining, I wanted to do our drawing for our book. Here we go. I have a pumpkin because that was handy. And as I'm shaking this around to see who gets a free copy of the book, I also want to make sure everyone knows the library is open. We are open full hours, our pre-pandemic hours. You can come in, use a computer. We have a lot of virtual programming going on. We've got a lot of fun stuff in store for you this summer. Our gallery is putting together an amazing exhibit. Our cafe is open. Our boutique is open. So please come see us and look for me in the stacks. I'd love to chat with you about books. Andrew put some information about Roundtable's book club in the chat, and the library also sponsors a number of book clubs, and we'd love to see you if you want to connect with other readers.